Deadline is set and the rules announced, and the race for the next Conservative Party leader is officially on. There are the candidates we know are running, those we expect to announce soon or still considering, and then there's the one we just don't know. But there are also changes happening behind the scenes. Former Prime Minister Stephen Harper resigned from the Conservative Fund's board, raising questions about his role during the leadership contest.
Okay, so what does this first week tell us, if anything, about the race so far, and how will this contest be different from the last one? It's Thursday, and At Issue is here. Chantal Hébert is in Montreal. Andrew Coyne is in Toronto. And Althea Raj is in Ottawa tonight. Good to see everybody. I want to start a little bit on the rules, not, you know, get into the details, but the fact that the entrance fee is the highest ever, that there's some that's refundable, some that's not, that you have to get 3,000 signatures. That already changes the nature of how this race is going to unfold, and we've already seen that this week. Chantal, you start us off.
Yes, it's clearly meant to provide a disincentive to anyone who would have wanted to use the leadership campaign to raise his or her profile. The bar is set too high on all kinds of scores for that to happen. That probably means that it will be a smaller field than the happy dozen or so that we saw last time.
And is that a good thing, Andrew, or?
Well, it's not a particularly democratic thing. I mean, it will also exclude people who might not be able to raise a lot of money out of the gate, but might have a great message or an appealing campaign persona and might be able to catch fire. So you've got these rules that have profound implications for favoring one type of candidate over another type of candidate that are basically being set by a bunch of appointees sitting in a back room somewhere. It's a hell of a way to run a railroad, frankly.
Well, two things. One, it's clear that there is a desire, especially among those in the upper echelons of the party, to choose a leader quickly that has already name recognition across the country in the case that the government falls and that there's an election. There isn't a lot of groundwork to do. And so in some ways, you can look at these rules and say, they seem to be designed for that. That being said, the rules are kind of progressive. You only need 1,000 signatures from the get-go. You only need to put in $25,000 immediately. So there are different steps to reach along the way. So technically, I do think that there is a potential that you could get new voices should those individuals wish to come out of the woodwork. You know, you also want to be able to choose a leader that can raise money. It's so fundamental that if you can't raise $300,000, frankly, like, that's not that much money. The max now is almost $1,700 per person. So.
Right. I think the better rule I would have liked to see would be that you have to have the support of a certain number of members of caucus, because that is who the leader is ultimately going to have to lead. That is who he or she should be accountable to on a day-to-day basis. This business of having leadership races where you have membership drives with tens of thousands of new members who come out of nowhere and disappear the day after they vote is what keeps saddling parties with leaders who are repugnant to the caucus and wind up getting in trouble for the party.
Okay, let's talk. Go ahead, Chantal.
Two things. First, someone who would be the aspiring prime minister, maybe in 18 months, should be someone who brings enough experience. It's not an entry-level position. Yes. Second thing, I'm not sure that the system brings repugnant leaders, or at least I suspect that the Liberals, for one, would beg to differ on the score of having had Justin Trudeau elected as leader at the time when they were in third place and being predicted to be going nowhere first.
No, what it does in that case is you get a leader who's accountable to nobody. But what we've seen is you've got leaders like Andrew Scheer, who basically got elected by a bunch of dairy farmers from Quebec who did not have the best interest of the Conservative Party in mind. You had the progression of Patrick Brown in the Ontario Conservative Party and then Doug Ford in the Conservative Party. You get people being elected by a bunch of people who have no real connection or attachment to the party, who come in solely on the basis of mass membership sales. It's not a sound way. It's not the way other countries run their leadership races. I don't think it's one that really stands the test of scrutiny in Canada.
Okay, can I just say that's not really fair about Andrew Scheer? I mean, the dairy farmers might have inflated
I want to talk about who's running. Go ahead.
His standings early on, but he was the consensus candidate of people who, you know, were members at the time. You don't get to the 12th round ballot or whatever it was in 2017 without having pretty deep support in the party.
Well, and social conservatives certainly pushed him over the edge, too. Okay, I this is all great. It's great you have no opinions whatsoever about this. But what about the people who are running so far, two names that are out there, and then the other names that are sort of floating around for now? What does that tell us about what kind of race this might be? Chantal, you go.
It does not yet tell us much of anything, because we are in what I would call the fake war period of the leadership campaign, where everyone and his sister or brother, under the cover of anonymity, will be close to someone and tell you something that maybe is not true because they're not really close to someone. And we, the media, are actually peddling all this stuff, absent words. You know, this week, if you read all the stories that came out, regardless of what they said, you would think that the cat ate the tongue of Rona Ambrose, Jean Charest, and that everyone needs to talk on their behalf. So we are not anywhere near what this is shaping up to be like.
That would be fair, I think, Andrew, that everybody's talking, but not actually the people that plan to run or are thinking about running.
Sure, but what I think you can say as the broad outline, because it's true of most leadership races, is the party's dilemma, as it is for many parties, is that oftentimes the candidate that can win the party can't win the general election, and vice versa. The party that can win the general election, candidate who can win the general election can't win the party. Mm-hmm. You've got candidates like Jean Charest and Peter MacKay who might be quite attractive to centrist voters, not necessarily hardcore conservatives, but who've got a real hard row to hoe to sell themselves to the membership at large, particularly in Western Canada. You can see them already trying to buttress their conservative, small-c conservative credentials by hiring people who've got that kind of right-wing voice and connections, but they themselves are going to have a real selling job in that regard.
Althea?
If you were reading the stories this week, you would conclude that there are people, whether it's one camp or two camps, who really don't want Jean Charest to run.
Yes.
You know, the first, the leak about his connections to Huawei, and now the story that Harper has resigned from the Conservative Fund so that he can prevent or campaign against Jean Charest, which I'm told by people close to the former prime minister that is hogwash. It is very interesting that there's already an attack against a candidate that hasn't even declared.
Yeah, I wonder what that tells us, because I mean, I was told the same thing about Stephen Harper and the Conservative Fund, but at the same time, people are very willing to talk to you about how much he dislikes Jean Charest for personal reasons that our friend Paul Wells has talked about, but also for ideological reasons. So, does that show us that Jean Charest is a real threat, or that Stephen Harper is overly interested in the future of the party? I mean, what does that tell us? Go ahead,
Chantal. Two things. The first, yes, Jean Charest is a real threat to a number of the other candidates. And yes, he does represent, in the eye of many, and I suspect that would include Stephen Harper, a kind of reverse takeover by the former progressive wing of the party, of the reins of power within the party. That being said, Stephen Harper would not be the first former leader to feel that a front runner or a possible front runner is not the person that is best to keep the soul of the party intact. And I bring you back to Ed Broadbent, who campaigned quite openly for someone other than Thomas Mulcair, in part because he made no secret of the fact he didn't believe Thomas Mulcair should be Jack Layton's successor. So
I'm
told the expectation is that the former prime minister is actually probably not going to campaign actively for a candidate. And obviously there's no, I would say, huge feelings of warmth between Jean Charest and Stephen Harper, but we are also likely going to see a leadership race with at least three, possibly four, former Harper cabinet ministers. Why would he be campaigning for Jean Charest when there's people from his own team, including people that he has rather warm relationships with, who are running for this job?
Yeah, but it's one thing to not campaign for someone. It's another thing to campaign against someone.
Yeah, I don't think that's going to happen.
I don't know, but it can happen through whispers. It can happen through people. Like, the fact that we even know that this is something that people are talking about is probably
because
not
they
a
want
good
us
sign.
To talk about it.
Yes, that's fine. That's fine,
but
Andrew.
It's not unprecedented.
No, it's not unprecedented.
Happened.
Fair.
It will happen.
Fair.
It's not the end of the world. It's all part of a succession battle.
Okay, Andrew, weigh in.
It'd be remarkable to see Harper actually publicly campaigning. I doubt we'll see that. He may make representations behind the scenes, but I can't see why he would see Charest as being that much of a threat. He's not a particularly conservative person to begin with. His record is not particularly conservative. He's got more than a whiff of corruption surrounding the government that he led in Quebec, and if not him personally. He's got this Huawei business where he's been a consultant to the company that is at the heart of this business where China is holding our hostages. He's got so many knocks against him that I think he's, to say that he's the front runner, I think would be really pushing at this point.
He's not running yet in any.
No. Okay, well, one quick round on Rona Ambrose. What do you think, Chantel, if you had to bet?
I've heard black and white on this, but at some point it is clear that she will be or have to say something.
Yes.
And it seems to me that if she hasn't yet, it's because she is or has been tempted. Because otherwise, it's easy enough to rule yourself out. It
sure.
only takes 7 words on the social media to run or not to run. So.
Yes.
I've looked at her social media feed. I noticed that the last entry 6 days ago is about John Crosby.
Yes.
It's not a bad thing to be right next to someone who was identified as a major red Tory, whatever you may be thinking about your future.
30 seconds, Andrew, and Althea, you got to share it. Andrew.
Well, I think a candidate like Rona Ambrose is what a lot of people are looking for, which is somebody with credibility in the West who can also reach out to Central Canada. And so far, we haven't seen candidates who can bridge that divide. Mm-hmm. I think very effectively. Whether Rona Ambrose is the person is another matter.
Althea.
She has a very nice life at the moment, and she now needs to weigh whether she will regret not jumping into this contest, and I think that's why we have not heard from her yet. That being said, a lot of people do really want her to win, run, because they believe that she can win against Justin Trudeau, and they are not convinced that the rest of the people we're talking about can.
The number of politicians that leave their nice lives for politics are a lot. So we'll see whether she
ambition. It's
that's all
so
I
interesting.
Thank you all. Good conversation. We'll talk many more times about all this, of course.